Laker comes in again, hair flopping. Bowles turns it on to Maddock, appeals, he's out LBW, and Laker's taken all 10. Trueman in again. Bowles to Hawk, and Hawk goes forward, and he's caught. There's the 300.
And a freaker.
A freaker.
We've got a freaker down the wicket now, not very shapely, and it's masculine. And I would think it's seen the last of its cricket for the day.
Thompson comes in, bowls to Boycott. Boycott pushes that. There must be a run out here. Oh, how tragic. How tragic, how tragic, how tragic.
And Liaquat comes in, bowls to Gower. And Gower turns. It's his first ball of cricket before the hand swelling. Ah, oh, what a princely entry.
John Arlott's Cricketing Wides, Byes and Slips. Presented by Peter Baxter.
I remember listening to Howard Marshall far before the war, to be about 1937, I suppose. So it was in the days when I was more interested in playing cricket than listening to it. But the memory is absolutely distinct.
John Arlott was to become more celebrated as the voice of cricket than even that pre-war pioneer, Howard Marshall. He started in 1946.
I just achieved my aspiration of becoming a poetry producer in the BBC, and I was in the Eastern Service, and we had a programme planning meeting in January 1946, and the head of service, Donald Stevenson, said, "Isn't there an Indian cricket team," he said, with a rather distasteful tone, "coming this summer?" And I said, "Yes, there is." "Oh, yes," he said, "I remember from your interview, you're keen on cricket. When do they start?" I said, "The first Wednesday in May." "Where?" he said. I said, "Worcester." "Yeah, where do they go then?" I said, "Oxford." He said, "How do you know?" I said, "Because I've got the fixture list in my office." He said, "Have you ever done a cricket broadcast?" "Yes," said I, stretching the truth, because all I'd ever done was a 15-minute talk about Hambledon. But he said, "Would you like to do it?" And I thought someone had turned me upside down. It was impossible. So I gasped out, "Yes." He said, "Can you do your programmes and that as well?" And I said, "Yes." For me, it was a sort of seventh heaven to be watching cricket and talking about it and being paid for it.
By 1948, when Don Bradman brought one of the greatest Australian sides to England, Arlott was part of the regular team, which broadcast ball-by-ball commentary to Australia and large slices of it to the domestic audience. Australia won at Trent Bridge and at Lord's, and by drawing the third test at Old Trafford, ensured that they retained the Ashes. At the Oval, Don Bradman played his last test match. Rex Alston described the scene as he came in to bat.
Well, it's a wonderful reception. The whole crowd is standing, and the England team are joining in, and led by Yardley, three cheers for the Don as he gets to the wicket. Yardley went up to Bradman and shook him by the hand and then called for three cheers, and now the crowd settled down again. They've got 40 minutes more left for play, and Bradman is now taking guard. Hollies is going to bowl at him, and John Arlott shall describe the first ball. So come on, John.
Well, I don't think I'm as deadly as you are, Rex. I don't expect to get a wicket, but it's rather good to be here when Don Bradman comes in to bat his last test. And now here's Hollies to bowl to him. From the Vauxhall end, he bowls. Bradman goes back across his wicket. He pushes the ball gently in the direction of the Houses of Parliament, which are out beyond mid-off. It doesn't go that far. It merely goes to Watkins at silly mid-off. No runs, still 117 for one. Two slips, a silly mid-off, and a forward short leg close to him as Hollies pitches the ball up slowly, and he's bowled. Bradman, bold, hollies, not. Bold, hollies, not. And what do you say under those circumstances? I wonder if you see a ball very clearly in your last test in England, a ground where you played out some of the biggest cricket of your life, and where the opposing team have just stood round you and given you three cheers and the crowd has clapped you all the way to the wicket. I wonder if you really see the ball at all. Anyway, Bradman went forward, it was Holly's googly, it clean bowled him, groping right down the pitch, and he was just beaten all the way. I think he was completely out of his crease and would have been stumped if it hadn't hit the wicket. He didn't seem to make any attempt to get back. He knew it had bowled him. Australia are 117 for two in reply to England's 52.
Despite the failure of Bradman, Australia were heading for an innings victory.
Bill Johnston's bowling, and here he comes from the Vauxhall end, and he bowls to Hollies, and Hollies swings him hard and high. Everyone's stolen stumped, and Morris has caught him. It took an awful long time to come down. Every stump was out of the ground and every bale was in a player's pocket before Arthur Morris made that catch. And England are all out 188. All out 188. Barnes has got a stump. Neither Young nor Hollies has. And now... Yes, they both got bats. And... as a small boy wants their autographs, he's being removed by two policemen, by a policeman and an official. Umpire Davies has got a stump. Loxton's got a bail. And now, in almost complete silence, these last two batsmen, Jack Young, not out three.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.